Thanks for the very kind and not really deserved words. As I said, it's actually quite cool to be. I was a lot closer to Zalando than I've been to about you, but still, it's very impressive to sit on the advisory board of that company. And I have to say, I was one of the people that thought it's a really bad idea to start a fashion company 4 years ago. And I'm still amazed and impressed how well it went. And I think a lot of it has to do with how Tarek said, and I think Tarek's speech was a great opening speech for mine, because it basically shows what I think, at least, more and more is increasingly relevant also for fashion companies, where you might think creative or creativity is like the main source for a successful fashion company. That's certainly still true. But I think what you definitely need is a certain level of technology competence and a certain level of data competence. And I think the really difficult part, and I think that is something that even in Amazon and other companies haven't nailed, is bringing the two DNAs together. Because often you either have a creative DNA or you have a data tech DNA. And I think what you need to be a really successful fashion company is to put both kind of DNAs in different departments of the company on the same kind of organization. So just quickly about us, but I'll just do that in 1 minute. As Ole said, we invest all over Europe. We do 6 to 8 investments per year. We still invest in B2C businesses, but I think what's really important to understand, the VC business has definitely changed. So something like a Zalando or an About You, you would not invest in today, very likely, as a European investor, because one has to be very honest about it. I think Europe has kind of lost the B2C space, mostly. I mean, there's few exceptions, obviously. Booking.com is a company from Europe. Obviously, you guys are doing well. Zalando is doing quite well. But if you look overall, Europe is falling greatly behind in terms of B2C. Yeah? So the consumer space is basically lost to Chinese and American platform companies. And I think that's important to understand, and has great implications also for basically everybody in that ecosystem. That's why we invest quite a lot into technology companies that enable players like fashion players, but also anybody else, any manufacturer, to be more successful in the platform economy. I'll come to the point why I think that's necessary now. What are the framing kind of developments that I currently see? And I think that's very important to understand for any company. So basically, if you look in the digital world today, the new user access, so the attention of users, is controlled by very few companies. It's Google, Amazon, Facebook, and Apple in the Western world, and it's Alibaba, Tencent, Baidu, and maybe JD in the Chinese world. These are controlling 80-90% of user attention in the world. And everybody else that wants to take part in user attention or in converting user attention to a service or product you want to sell needs to deal with these platforms. And we call those the first order platforms. So Google, Facebook, Amazon, Alibaba, Tencent, etc. Those are first order platforms because they're dominating verticals, or not only one vertical, but they're actually dominating the space across verticals. And then you have so-called second order platforms, like potentially Zalando, Booking.com, Airbnb, that own a specific space. And I think the maximum you can probably reach today as a European internet company is becoming a second order platform. So trying to dominate a space or trying to dominate a certain aspect of a vertical. That's exactly what you guys are trying to do. So that's like the most realistic kind of thing. So you might say, what does it have to do with me that there's obviously a very limited number of platforms controlling user attention? The problem with this user attention is that this user access is not given for free. Tarek has pointed that out. Yeah? Instagram followers are basically irrelevant or increasingly irrelevant. Facebook followers are basically increasingly irrelevant. Why? Because Facebook and Instagram are heavily monetizing the organic reach of your followership. So what they ask you to do is they basically say, yes, you can still reach your followers, no problem. You can still reach all the users that we have, but user access is not for free anymore. It costs money and is actually working with an underlying auction mechanism. So what these platforms are essentially doing, they put themselves between the user and any type of company offering services, and the user access in between is auctioned off. It's like a stock exchange. So essentially, these people or these platforms are monetizing their oligopoly of user access, and you are the ones that have to pay for it. And the problem that you basically see arising from this is that the margin of anybody else on this side, so the manufacturers, the retailers that want to have user access, you see a systematic redistribution of their margin to the platform players that are sitting in the middle. Yeah, and if you look at the most 10 most valuable companies today in the world, it used to be BP, Exxon, these type of companies. Today it's Google, Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Alibaba, Tencent, plus Microsoft, which is actually quite curious because Microsoft somehow made it into the platform world. Yeah, so the 10, all of these companies, just to give you a perspective, are worth more than the whole DAX 30, that's the 30 most valuable companies in Germany combined. Yeah? So Amazon is worth 6 times SAP, just to give you a perspective. 7 times Bayer Monsanto, to give you a perspective. So these companies are huge. And even Zalando is a 60th of the market capitalization of Amazon. Yeah? And that is something that I think in the order of magnitude has not really sunk in. Yeah, and why is that? Because the stock market expects your margin to go to them. Yeah, and that's what they're basically already foreseeing, and that's why these companies are worth so much. So what can you do? And that leads me to the point of why data competence is so important and why tech competence is so important, even for companies that are not essentially tech companies. Because who is winning in a platform economy? If you always have to go back to the same user and buy the user again, with an auction mechanism underlying, your margin will go to them. Yeah? So the only thing that brings you out of this, and I think Tarek showed that in a great way, about you is getting 3.5 to 5 orders per user, per year, not for free, but basically at a very limited type of marketing cost, because the users are coming back to you guys. They're discovering new trends. So about you is bypassing the platforms, at least partially. So about you is getting users in, they have a great experience on the platform, and then they come back at reduced marketing cost. So what you really need is, you need to be a company with direct access to users and with the ability to maintain active user relationships. And if you think about most fashion companies today, designers, you are all dependent on independent retail or third-party retail. Most of the companies have the largest share of merchandise still going to shops, to Zalando, to About You, and to Amazon. Yeah? And that is not great as a future outlook. So because in a platform economy with this kind of power distribution or distribution of power, the only thing to get around it is having access to your user yourself. Yeah? Or work with partners where you can rely on that they will not squeeze out your margin over time or replace you. Because you have two ways how the platform companies are pressuring you. The one is user access is getting more expensive through the auction mechanism. And the other is platforms are developing their own merchandise. If you see what Amazon is doing in the CPG category, so fast-moving consumer goods, 30 fast-moving consumer goods categories already. There, Amazon has introduced heavily their own private label brands. And the same thing you see in fashion. So Amazon, but also Otto Group, and obviously also Zalando, all of these guys, ASOS, they all have a strong kind of incentive to put their own brands to replace the stuff that independent designers and fashion companies are doing. And I think the only way around it, and if you see how, for example, Adidas is behaving, Under Armour is behaving, Nike is behaving, they all try to increase the share of direct-to-consumer interaction. And I think that is something that every company needs. But obviously, what do you need for this? And this leads me to the conclusion that you're only able to engage in a direct-to-consumer relationship in a digital world, or a primarily digital world that we're heading to, if you have a certain level of tech competence. That doesn't necessarily mean that you need to build your own shop or your own everything yourself, like a Zalando does or an About You. Obviously, I mean, Tarek talked about it. People like these guys are outsourcing their technology to other players. There's other options. There's Magento. There's a lot of options. But I think what's clear is you need, in any company, people that are able to decide in an educated kind of way what is the right technology-based consumer access approach, also in a fashion company. And the other thing where I'm pretty much convinced that you cannot outsource it, and that is for sure, who's winning in this world? People are winning that are able, like Tarek said, to put, identify users that are fashion forwards that will basically lead others to follow them. Yeah? So you need to be able to collect all the data points regarding individual users and act on it. You can do your product development based on data if you really understand what the direct-to-consumer kind of preferences are. So, and I think that's another argument for direct-to-consumer access. It's not just about Google and Facebook and Amazon eating your margin. It's also about improving your product development. And I think that's the other thing. Because if you just have indirect consumer interaction through retail, you'll never be as good in adapting your product development in sense of fashion development to user preferences as you would be if you would have the same people on your website at least partially. So that's why, for example, Adidas is trying to double their direct-to-consumer revenue share in the next 2-3 years, because they've really recognized if we rely on third-party retail over time, it will definitely decrease our competitive position. So that's why it's necessary to have, on the one hand, tech people, and on the other hand, data people as part of your organic organization. That's exactly the reason why Tarek talked about it. Even in a buying department, which I, at least, the buying departments I've seen are probably the most data-distant departments in fashion companies, even there, you have tech people and you have data people dedicated to helping the buying people in the department to make better data-driven and technology-based decisions. And I think that sounds probably a little unfamiliar and absurd in the beginning, but I think it's without alternative if you think in the next 5 to 10 years. So what are other hypotheses that you can draw from that? What are actionable takeaways you should draw from this? So One driver of basically active customer interactions or customer relationships is obviously CRM. Yeah? So the big asset, or one of the big assets that somebody like About You or also somebody like Zalando has, is a big active customer base that they're able to address. Yeah? So there's an asset in being able to contact your users, your customers, or the people that are interested in you. Yeah? So building your own newsletter base, building your own followership in whatever channel, being able to collect all the data points of every individual user and having this in your own hands and in your own sphere is definitely something that is per se an asset to have, and every fashion company needs to have this. I'm pretty much convinced of this. And the other thing that you will see, what is the major mechanism at work in a platform economy? It's basically all about who has the highest level of monetization per user contact. What do I mean by that? In Amazon, in Zalando, and About You, all of these companies are able to say with high degree of accuracy if they buy a certain user, whether it's on Facebook, on Instagram, Taboola, Outbrain, or Google, they're able to say which kind of monetization level is connected with the very contact they're just delivering to the platform. So they have an understanding of how many cents, how many euros they're going to earn with that user contact they're just buying. And the other thing that you'll see is all of these companies are very actively working on bringing up the monetization level per user. Yeah? So all the platform companies that are successful in this world don't just have one revenue stream. And Tarek talked about it. They have the fashion retail business. That's one thing. The same thing goes for Zalando. But then Zalando starts selling their own warehousing capacity to third-party brands to make basically the same infrastructure, reuse that. They have the Zalando advertising platform. You just said the same thing. Otto Group has the same thing. They have the Otto Media Group, where they're trying to monetize the user profiles that they're generating also. In alternative ways, not just use it for themselves, but also sell it to advertisers and other brands. And I think that's the next thing everybody needs to think about, that very likely one monetization stream, so selling fashion, is probably not enough to get your monetization level per user high enough to compete in this platform economy, because other people will have a higher chance of monetizing higher. And that's a problem, because if your Otto Group and Amazon monetizes every user with a higher conversion rate, even in a retail business on a higher level. And then Amazon at the same time has a cloud business with AWS that produces a lot of free cash flow per user contact, then it's very, very hard in this kind of world to stay competitive. Yeah. So, and I think that's one of the most difficult natures of a platform economy, that very likely one single business model is not enough to keep you monetizing high enough to be successful. You need more business models. And if you think about how many how long in the past companies have been able to run one company business model, it used to be 20, 25 years you were able to run on one business model. Now, if you look at how long a company is staying in the Standard & Poor's index, that's a major American stock exchange index, companies are now in that index for only 9 years. So after 9 years, companies that have been running on one business model, got into the stock exchange index, are kicked out of the index again because they're not successful enough to stay in the index again. So the half-life of specific business models goes down. And I think that is something you need to consider as well. To finish this off, I think one element here is really about how can you make your user experience, if you have a direct-to-consumer experience, how can you make that unique? Yeah, and that does not necessarily mean that you'll provide a better shopping experience than Amazon or a better shopping experience than Zalando. That will very likely not happen. But I think one thing one has to think about is, what is the extra service? What is the extra element of a user experience that I can offer as a fashion company or as a player there that others probably cannot offer? And very likely, that is going to be based on technology and or data. And I think the only way you'll be able to do this is have dedicated people there. And one last thing, and then I conclude. What everybody needs to understand is that this kind of competence very likely cannot be outsourced at least completely. So you cannot just go to Accenture and say, build me this and build me that. You can certainly outsource elements of this. But I think what's important, that every company, I think at least, that wants to stay alive in this environment, needs to have data people in-house and tech people in-house that can take informed decisions on what to do in-house, what to do outsource, and coordinate the whole thing. Cool. So thanks a lot. That was basically my few minutes.